This is a special moment for me, as I symbolically assume the Vice Chancellorship of Wits University. A university that is my alma mater. A university that is the alma mater of Nelson Mandela, the father of our nation and the icon of our world. Like all of our institutions in this beautiful yet tragic land, Wits reflects our country's pains and its euphoria, its successes and its failures. I want to apologize as its new Vice Chancellor to all those we have done wrong by, and to pledge that we collectively will work towards creating a safe, student-centered, non-racial, culturally plural and sensitive, cosmopolitan academic environment.
You sit in these institutions and you think you're in Cambridge. That was purposeful. These institutions were made primarily for white, middle-class men. These institutions were, in fact, a primary part of building and developing apartheid South Africa and colonial Africa. And so what you have is university students coming of age who've gone through good schooling, but have also been at the coalface of experiencing racism, exclusion, and the kind of denial of who people are.
When a student like myself or another student is learning something about the world from a point of view that tells you that nothing happened in Africa outside of a colonial experience, for example, it cannot be sustainable.
They came from the west and sailed via the east, with hatred and disease flowing on their flesh, and a burden to harden our lives. They claimed to be friends when they found us friendly, and when they met with foreigners, they fought for the race, exploiters of Africa. Africa, my beginning, and Africa, my end.
Our history is a nightmare from which we're still trying to awake. If you want people to have a shot at changing the socioeconomic reality that they've inherited, then you have to prioritize higher education.
Who's gonna pay your balance of the fees? My parents. Yeah. Did they make a payment arrangement?
In first year, there were 50 of us in our class. And second year, there were like 20. We had to see people that we knew very closely, our friends, not coming back to school.
Post-1994, we get a massification, which means that these universities get opened up to black people and to poor people and to women in ways that was historically not possible. As you have this happening, you have the state withdrawing subsidy.
They there was an argument made in the 90s, particularly by people in positions of power at the time, that we needed to think more critically about priorities. And it was felt that higher education wasn't one of those priorities.
How are you?
My knee.
The big universities, the ones with brand value, the ones where the elite used to go, increase their fees by double digits. The logical thing to do, because as the subsidies get, you want to retain quality, you increase fees. The poorer universities couldn't do it. So they did increase fees, but by lower amounts.
Our future, you barter. Look at the freedom charter. Sent the police and armored V's, but our fathers were martyrs. See the greed that you harbor. See the seed that you planted. This university is lying to me. See what you started. So much for liberation. We were never born free of deceit or desperation. They say we set fire to the nation, but all we want is decolonization.
It's a space where you don't have a language. We don't think that the way the university is structured favors students. We think that, you know, there's no way students can ever win anything.
I was taking three to my lawyers as well there, so it's just...
Three.
The clear message that we have for the university is that we can't continue like this.
The thing is, it's very difficult to describe.
It was a very up figure and a very high figure. Were we going to accept the increase or were we going to fight? And we were clear that we were going to fight.
Then speak to the World Bank and people and say to them, we're talking.
I had a meeting with President Zuma, which I wrote on behalf of all of the vice chancellors at the end of September, saying we're heading for the perfect storm.
Where's the next meeting?
It's now at 12:30.
Shaeera slept over at my house that night. I remember the morning we wake up. Mom's like, do you want some tea? No, we're fine, we're fine. Oh, you guys are going to visit early? Yeah, no, we have work. Don't tell your parents what you're about to physically block the gates with your bodies.
I knew that there was going to be a march, but from experience, when the SRC organizes a march, it never yielded any result. So I wasn't interested, even though the fees must fall issue spoke directly to me. I really wasn't interested.
We can't protest the same way we used to protest, as to give a memorandum and so on. We need to shut down this university.
The numbers that came gave us confidence to continue shutting down. We're going to go for the long haul. You know, we're in it now.
So when I read the email saying that any student who participates in the protest will be suspended and we will call the police, I was like, this is pure intimidation. And me being interested in social justice and human rights and all of that, I got angry. I was livid. I was like, you can't do that. That was my first awakening. We have been, as Black people, excluded from the education system for such a long time. If we are interested about this thing called transformation, then we have to ensure that there's justice. This is like a food security project. Whatever food is produced from here goes to the food bank and gets given to the students that are beneficiaries of the food bank program.
Thank you.
Many academics find themselves throughout the year being approached by students for money to buy food. You have poorer students who have to sit in the same class as students who, when their first year, when they pass matric, their parents buy them a Mercedes-Benz or BMW so they can drive to university. The inequality is far more manifest at a place like Wits University and other former, you know, English-speaking or, you know, the top white universities. And these things contribute to the kind of consciousness and the politics that have evolved in the Feast Must Fall movement.
Not only are students oppressed by the violence of the system in that they're financially excluded, but so are workers, right? And to an even worse extent, because workers have even less agency than students do, right? In some ways, the university needs us to exist, as opposed to workers who can be more easily replaced.
We are not employed by Wits, but we work under the contracted companies. In 2001, when this outsourcing started, the employers who were employed by Wits, they now became ex-Wits, and what they lost was up to half their salaries, and they no longer had medical aid. With the contract companies, you work for years and years, and when you go on pension, you get next to nothing. The beast in the house was this outsourcing, and we decided that we should have a national day against outsourcing.
Ideally, it's part of the same struggle. You want a more just society, you want a dignified society, and you want a decommodified university.
Universities are being modeled around the way that companies operate.
You see the workers at our universities as our mothers and fathers.
We have a responsibility not just to come here to study, but to go back into our communities and to make sure that we are uplifting and empowering our communities. Yes. And if we leave here without doing that, we will have failed as Wits students. Yes. Thank you very much. Amandla!
Running on the steam of October 6, you now have students, workers and like-minded academics who are on the same page, not just about insourcing, but also on the issue of fee increases. Not only do we outnumber the university management and staff, but together as workers and students, there's nothing we can't do.
They didn't make me sit on the floor. I came here, I walked with them, and I sat. I was criticized by the Vice Chancellor. They said I gave breath to the struggle. I gave oxygen to it. In some senses, they're right. I did.
So Adam sees himself both as a scholar of the left and as a participant of the left, now finding himself in a position of authority, in which that authority has constantly been challenged by this emerging student movement.
Adam Habib, in his student days, was probably the equivalent of what we are now. I don't know, I didn't know him when I wasn't alive, but we hear that he was progressive.
He was involved in the Black student movement, and in his early career as an academic in Natal, was regarded as one of the most kind of radical members of the emerging new Black academy, demanding unionization at universities and fighting for a particular kind of transformation.
I believe profoundly that the world will be a far better place if we lived and created a more egalitarian outcome. The struggle for a free education system is an important plank in that egalitarian project.
I do recognize the 10.5 as high. I will commit to motivate to bringing it down, provided there's a concomitant increase from the state.
My mandate is to keep this university a quality institution. And that means I need to keep its income streams. So there's no way I'm giving zero until the state makes up that money.
Never before had a meeting of this nature taken place where the university management, the executive committee of council, would have to sit in front of students and engage with the students.
It is not Adam who's in charge of this university anymore, it's the students. Yeah. The university, as we stand now, is under new management. And that management is sitting here.
In the history of Wits, there's only been 9 university assemblies. This is an occasion where the entire university comes and decides on a particular issue, a burning issue.
Council starts micromanaging this.
Who's going to speak? What are they going to say? And where is it going to be? It's as though they didn't realize that things had changed. The power structure in the university had been inversed. And actually, the students really, for a moment, for a while, were in control. This was really a revolutionary moment.
They had blocked off Sodom and Mahlangu House. They had completely shut it down. They had put private security, campus control. But campus control was on our side. And we obviously knew that they wanted to meet on the lawns because it's much easier to disperse people in an open area. Around 1 o'clock, they still hadn't opened it up.
Why aren't you addressing the students at this hour, Professor?
If you want an engagement with both sides, you need integrity from both sides. And that's the position we set. What happened is the students broke into the concourse, they occupied a confined space, they violated health and safety protocols of the university. I can't waive those kinds of things.
If the university continues with their arrogance, it will hit hard on them, not us. We are going to hold the cloud.
I went to an Islamic school, a Muslim school. Christina, our domestic helper, I grew up with her son, and he came to the same school that I did. And the way that he was treated and the way that people saw him and because he was African was different. He had a lot of friends and he was popular, but there was always this us versus them. And for me, that always made me very aware of race. The idea of social justice in Islam has always been very clear. If you can actually contribute to structural change, for me, that's a religious duty. Early on, there were problems, and it wasn't easy to be a woman and to be a leader.
That this is a revolution. It's not going to be one issue that we fight. It's going to be many issues.
Despite the fact that myself and Yulo were the elected leadership, it was really our decision to protest and our decision to shut down the university. We had to allow for Vuyani and Mcebo to be alongside us.
If you looked at the first few days of the protest, whether it was images circulated in media or social media, it was the image of Vuyani and Mcebo Dlamini instead of the image of Nompendulo and Shaeera, who were the incoming and outgoing SRC president.
We created a WhatsApp group. It was Mbogodo must lead.
Mbogodo being women, strong women.
And that's where we started to formulate really how women were going to reclaim their space.
They agree on forms of representation. One is the hashtag, which is Mboko lead. And then the other was going to be the wearing of the duk during the occupation the next day. So the duk is a head wrap. We buy what we can afford at the time, and we're tying duks. And what was interesting was about what would happen in photographs that would come up of the protest, that women would be more collectively visible.
We started seeing more of Shaeera, we started seeing more of Nompendulo, and it's because there was a movement brewing by women, feminists.
It's also changing the character of the movement. It's not just marginalization, sidelining that's being put on the table. It's also the ways in which we speak to each other. It's masculinist forms of organizing that are being questioned.
Black women, black lesbian women, transsexual women have stood up into leadership positions because there has been a space that has said, let us recognize that racism and capitalism is problematic, but that patriarchy and homophobia is right up there too.
I think the last time we had a significant generational conflict was the 60s, early 70s. And I think we're entering that moment again. You're beginning to see it in multiple manifestations. You're seeing it in the emergence of student protests in South Africa. You also see it in the emergence of youth involved in service delivery protests in ordinary society. you're seeing in the emergence in the United States of Black Lives Matter.
That statue symbolizes the exclusion of black bodies from a particular space. And it stands there proudly at the entrance of the university. And that symbolism is a representation of how much needs to change.
Can have an education that is number one Afrocentric, where African ideas are at the center and are important and are as overemphasized as Western ideas are, where we have African ideas being valued, African knowledge systems being valued, then for me, that is decolonization. We got comfortable at Solomon House. It was so important in building unity and solidarity amongst ourselves. Education team also started playing around with the idea of what would a decolonized library look like. So it provided also an alternative. It created a world we wanted to live in.
I've noted two.
We opened the room up for lecturers to come and teach, see if your ideas will find expression. Let's put them to a test. Let's think through together.
I think there was something about affirming a way of knowing something that has not been affirmed in this place. It was a language, a song your grandmother sang with you. You feel something you've known your whole life is being affirmed. And for you to claim like that space is like you own the land, you know?
By Monday, we had a call to meet the minister. And when the minister had engaged us, the idea of a 6% emerged, which is inflation, no real increase. We bought into that.
The stakeholders agreed to encourage their respective constituencies to engage in institutional negotiations at universities with a view to achieve a fee increase of not higher than a CPI-related increase of 6% for 2016.
What if the students on the ground reject our proposal?
The students don't accept this. We'll start our own movement. Students must fall.
The anger among students had built, workers had joined us, people were going to parliament in mass. Students had entered from like the back of parliament, and all of a sudden the gate was open in the front and we just entered. When you got inside, that's when the shit hit the fan.
Police respond differently to white protesters. And so quite spontaneously, white protesters were asked to offer themselves into the front of the march such that they could protect some of the black students. And it worked once or twice, but when they got to parliament and people realized that, hey, these people, doesn't matter what color, they're gonna storm this parliament. This is like an historic event that we need to stop this.
I had never seen the power of students like that fighting back.
What do I have? What do I have? Why are you here? Why are you
Fuck you, we're doing this for your children also. You can't afford these fees as well, and you're here going to abuse us.
These are the emergence of some sort of beginnings of a national coalition that exists outside of the control of the ANC-aligned movement. But it really just represents a growing movement that people are realizing that they need to work together in order to make any gains.
You are so powerful, you closed parliament from Johannesburg.
I put it to the house. Why don't we go to the Tuli house? This is where the powers are. Let's go there.
Mcebo would constantly come to me and say, Chief, do you see these numbers? And they were like increasing as we were going. UJ was now there. Fitz was now there. Ordinary people were there. There were even buses of people we did not anticipate.
The PYA knew that without the EFF, the numbers would shrink, right? The EFF knew that without the PYA, the numbers would shrink, right? But equally, with those numbers there, we could not fully play party line. We had to, all the time, speak first and foremost as students. That was our first identity.
Is denying us free education? It's the government. Who runs the government? Which political party runs the government? It's the ANC.
This is where the freedom charter is even written in the world. The cause of learning will be proclaimed for all. The revolution doesn't come to you, you take it.
Mantashe is standing there on the stage, and I say, guys, this is not going to happen. This guy must come down here. There's no stage to be assumed by anyone.
And we come down to the people.
The Fees Must Fall movement came about organically. It belongs to everyone and no one at the same time. And I think that's something that our elders sometimes forget, that we're structured in a very different way to the politics that they're used to.
And
there was a negotiation because Gwede Mantashe was like, I'm not coming out here. And then eventually he did. And then Fuyani pushed it forward and further and said, so you need to sit down with us.
Comrades, we agreed that we're going to make power sit down. We must not take back on that one. The SG must sit down like the people sat down. We must sit down.
And this was the moment where, of course, the ANC student leaders jumped in and changed the nature. When, in fact, the crowd was quite happy to see that happen.
Asking an elder to sit down on the road, I mean, it's very disrespectful. I approached him afterwards and I was saying, well, what were you doing? Because that was really out of order. We hadn't agreed to that. We were going to hand over our memorandum. We were going to then come back to Wits. We were not going to occupy Luthuli House. That was never part of the plan. And if it was part of the plan, we should have discussed it at the meeting.
The hashtag that was trending was occupy Luthuli House. I thought we were here to occupy. I thought you were here to ask power, what are you doing for this, for young people in this country? Why haven't fees fallen? Why do we have continued academic exclusion? But it was like when an ANC rally.
This letter is included as part of my visa application.
I got a call from the presidency saying, what do you think? After consultation with my VCs, I released a statement saying the university vice chancellors are backing the struggle, 0%. There are some people who say that, well, this is a flip-flop. Actually, I don't buy that. We see ourselves as progressives, but in a kind of managerial position, and we're governed by the systemic parameters. And when spaces open up, we take the opportunities. And when systemic parameters opened up after Wednesday morning, hey, you take the gap. It's not flip-flop, it's understanding how social struggle works and to actually engage in what I call a structural transformative struggle.
Agreed that there will be a zero increase of university fees in 2016.
We know that President Jacob Zuma has announced a 0% increase, but what the students were hoping for was for President Jacob Zuma to come and address them on the laws.
When we got there, we saw flames. We, as leaders, felt that it would be irresponsible to take students inside.
fire that we saw showed us that we weren't exactly as united and as on the same page as we thought we were.
What we saw as like kind of middle class activists was these guys taking the cops on and wanting to storm the union building. These are students from poor black higher education institutions who've in fact been struggling around exclusion for a long time.
No amount of stun grenade will ever make us deter from it. No one can stop an idea whose time has come.
The comrades who were inside saw Wits marching politely on the outside, and when Wits students wanted to jump on the bus, some of these other students went there and wanted to attack them and say, this is how you guys go back to your historically white institutions and settle for 0% and everything's okay. We can't do that. We're going to be excluded next year because we can't afford even the 0%.
There's nothing more violent than poverty. And we come from poverty-stricken homes. And that is why we are fighting for free education. We say it like, oh, we will not retreat, we will not surrender, as if it's a choice. But it really isn't, because if you do retreat, what are you left with?
There's a meeting where people from the ANC come and meet with their student representatives. As the story goes, there's a strong insistence that students must now go back to class. The president has spoken, the 0% is there, and therefore people must stop shutting down universities. And this is where quite a big rupture happens.
Before we knew it, there were a whole lot of students who'd come into the area accusing myself and Nompendulo of selling the movement out and having this meeting behind closed doors. The whole story was that we had been bribed to effectively say that we don't want the protest to continue and to go back to class. That created a lot of division. It was a very, very difficult point in the movement because there were clear reasons why we had to continue. And then there was just not enough momentum and not enough energy.
Most of the student movement wanted to return now. Exams were on, they were under pressure. It seemed like a group of students decided to go.
They all left in fear. And the Vice Chancellor, to his credit, sat in the chair, and a few of us stayed there.
We are taking instruction now. The university is under new management, the students are in charge.
It's coming down that if this must fall in sourcing.
If you could achieve the 0% fee increment in 1 week, maybe if we can push for longer, we can achieve more.
We have the university by the scruff of the neck. Why do we release it now when we can squeeze more out of it? The number was less, significantly less than it was before. But the workers were still there in the original number that they were in. So it was very difficult to look workers in the eye and say to them, we are done, we'll see your issue later.
Mm-hmm.
You've got to understand. Last night, there were cars burnt down. I'm not saying anybody here did it. I'm just saying there were cars burnt down. There was fire around the place. There were people physically removed from classes today. I can't carry on like this. I have to go back. I want to speak to the council and tell them, you asked me to communicate, I'm happy to communicate.
Kind of crazy.
You're looking good.
I don't
feel... This office is much better than your last.
Yeah, but I'm tired.
Next year,
I wish I could say yes immediately. I would be in violation of my mandate. I would have to understand the financial implications of the decision. I cannot make a decision now and declare bankruptcy 3 months later. That would be irresponsible.
I went to a black primary school. I had never interacted with white people in my life. It's only when I went to St. David's, which is a predominantly white school. People my age are being driven to school who live, you know, no less than 5 minutes away from school. And I was coming from Soweto to Sandton and had to wake up at 5 a.m. The story of overcoming for me was always there. The story about justice, and also the story about, you know, struggle and becoming, you know, was always there. So the revolution for me was there.
Okay, there is a worker here. There's a student there. An academic, Professor Noor. The university and the negotiators have agreed on the anti-black nature of outsourcing. And so the university has agreed with us in principle on insourcing.
If you think universities and education is able to transform radically society, what is the primary resource of a university? It's not the papers that get lodged in academic journals. It's the young people, the young minds that come through an institution. This has been a system that has really taught almost a hidden curriculum to everyone who comes through a university, that it's okay to treat poor black people as if they are subhuman.
We'd managed, you know, to show that if we're united and if we're mobilized, we actually have a very strong voice and we have a very strong influence over what happens at our universities and even in broader society.
We have to find the money now. I phoned the state. The state made very clear there's no support, which means we have to find 150 million rand. 150 million cut you can do once. You can't do it again. And if you implode this institution, you break the institutional mechanism that can address inequality in the society.
Oh yeah, your money here is 100 rand.
Okay. Let's do our research and then workers will sit and decide what's...
They planted the seeds of a different kind of politics. Our responsibility should be to help them to kind of water those seeds, nurture those seeds. Unfortunately, the response of the authorities, both the state and the university authorities, has been to smash all of it, try and clamp it down. What the state did and the university administrations in general, from late 2015, they began to prepare for 2016. When protests happened at the beginning of 2016, immediately the campuses were flooded with private security.
When I brought in the private security, instruction is no guns, no pepper spray. You can have riot shields, but you can't have weapons of aggression, if you like. There's strict controls.
We're in prison, yeah, monkeys are in prison.
It was a ridiculous amount of effort to to ensure that students didn't have safe places to meet. It was about killing the movement.
We felt so sorry for the student because you were not allowed to be in groups. As soon as they were seen in groups, they were intimidated.
The university space as a space of intellectual, robust intellectual engagement, of open democratic discussion, debate, needs to be protected. Protests must be seen as part of, in my view, the learning exercise, must be seen as part of what students engage with.
Because there was no occupation, we didn't have the time to iron out a lot of issues and really deal with the heart of what we were fighting for. We ended up fighting a lot in meetings, and obviously the loud and prominent voices would be the ones that are heard. When we spoke as women, you could tell by their body language. It's like they get bored. Up until one person stands up and says, you know what, we will not be led by women. And we will not be led by gay people, because this thing of gayness, it was started by the Greeks when they were bought. So 4th of April happens after there is this history. The Shambox was a way, number one, of resisting and revolting, but then it was also a way of saying that we are tired of being those vulnerable, fragile people. We will stand up for ourselves and we will fight.
Who is this revolution excluding? Who is that? Who is this revolution excluding?
The makeup of the movement is as important as the outcomes of the movement, because who makes up the movement translates into what the movement becomes. Some of the complications is when you try to hold a BC agenda, Black Consciousness agenda, with its kind of history of masculinity and misogyny, it's really difficult to hold that with intersectionality or the idea that patriarchy must fall too. We've had many conversations with our comrades where they're saying, but how can you take patriarchy away from us? This is the one thing we have. And now you're coming to say we must change ourselves. What do you mean?
We still view male leadership as the only leadership. Even when we had women leading, it was not enough until the male spoke. So that is the reality.
No one must pronounce in our name that women can't lead. No one must pronounce in our name that queer people cannot be here. There is no membership to the struggle.
Even as I want free education, I carry a lot already. And I cannot say, okay, let us focus on free education now. And we'll focus on me being a woman later.
So fallism is about all forms or symbols of oppression, you know, falling. All of them must fall. There must be none that is left.
Students at Wits University gathered at the admin buildings to hear Minister of Higher Education Bladen Zamande deliver his cabinet's decision on student fees.
We've looked at the challenges at hand from all sides.
and have concluded that the best approach would be to allow universities individually to determine the level of increase that their institutions will require to ensure that they continue to operate effectively. The fee adjustment should not go above 8%.
What we want is simple. Ours is free education. Now. Not when, now. So comrades, what's going to happen is that we're shutting down.
They will try to call us all sorts of names, but we're just children who are refusing to let the oppressive system deal with us.
Several university campuses have been shut down following the announcement by Higher Education Minister Bladen Zimande.
Students made their way up to Senate House. They were blocked from entering by private security.
The university came with private security and chased us out of Solomon Mahlangu House. And we returned, and it was a constant struggle to try and hold the ground, hold the fort.
Lectures cancelled, no classes till the end of the week, exams coming up shortly.
Call for a permanent shutdown. The permanent shutdown sacrifices the qualifications of 36,000 students, 80% of whom are black, 30% of whom are poor. When these kids don't qualify, their brothers and sisters are not able to go to education. That's what's in that book.
There was a view that the movement had sort of lost its way. This perspective that this group of students are nihilistic, which if you really sit and think about it, is absurd, because why would people be asking for free education if they were nihilistic?
This narrative in the media that students are only interested in burning down buildings is a false narrative. Education is not a privilege. On radio you hear, education is a privilege. No. Education is a right. Academics are standing up and saying we must protect education, higher education, and basic education as a public good.
How do we attain free education means having a conversation about what our priorities are as a society. Is it increased militarization? Or is it the ability for us to exist as equals, participate in the shaping of society as equals, being able to have, as members of a South African population, the ability to realize our dreams.
And then when I inquired about an arrested student, I then got arrested for asking too many questions.
We're gathering a forum of lawyers that are going to intervene, not just here, but nationwide. Let's go.
There's a difference between Mr. Now crossing the road and blocking the road. There is a big difference between the two. Cipher that out first and then start arresting. Do your job according to the laws of South Africa. There's a difference between crossing and blocking the road. Please, man. It's simple English. If I cross this road, are you going to shoot me? A student here crossing the road! You do not understand our pain! You do not understand our pain! They must give us free education. That's what we want in South Africa. That is what they promised us as the ANC in 1994. This university, and I quote, they say it works tirelessly to pressure the government. But we ask them, what is it that they do to pressure the government? They cannot give us a single answer. I want the public to know what goes on behind those walls. America!
The situation that you create is one of confrontation. You immediately escalate the nature of the engagement between protesters and police in a context where we know that in South Africa, yes, we have a legitimate government, but we do know that the police have been particularly violent against protesters since the 1990s. There are ample examples to show this. More people have died in police custody in the post-94 period than during apartheid.
We are here to make sure that black lives are not lost unnecessarily. If the police want to shoot our children, then they must shoot us first. I was the president of the Black Student Society here in 1985 and 86, and we were doing exactly what you are doing against the apartheid regime.
Phase of ISMA's fall had really phased off. And now we're dealing with a protest in the realest sense of the word, where there was a real threat of arrest, a real threat of you losing your eye, or the real threat of the police going bizarre and just shooting at people, even with live ammunition.
We need to be very clear as well that teaching and learning cannot take place in a securitized environment.
We see levels of violence emerging from private security and police. So this turn to instilling fear is something that contributes over the long term to a demobilization.
We're not protesting. We're not stopping. We're not undermining the movement. We support it. We just don't want the violence.
Then why don't you come to us?
That does not belong to the SRC. That belongs to those who study in this. We are all citizens. We all have the right to. Where were you yesterday? We all have the right to be here. Where were you? We all have the right to be here. We are not
here. At maximum, the protest has 700. This is not my numbers. It's FISMA's fall numbers. Compared to what existed in October, it was thousands. The question is, what do we do? Well, let's do it. Let's call a poll.
The poll quizzed students on whether or not they wanted the university to open next week. Of 21,730 responses, 77% voted to go back to class, while 23% voted otherwise.
Most students said, we support FISMA's fall. but we do not want to sacrifice our futures. Most students said, actually, we do not believe in a slogan that says, no free education, no education at all.
We had decided that a very significant move forward would be to get the university to publicly say that they support free education and they're willing to do what it takes with students to hold the state accountable.
They meet the students, they meet us, they meet the students. We develop a pledge where we would support the goal of free education. Then we are asked, well, will you march with us? I go to the Senate and Council and I say, will you walk, march with me? The Senate and Council agree to that. Senate and Council agrees to the goal of free education. We say we have a General Assembly. They agree to that.
We were going to go for this General Assembly, have the MBs or have whatever, but ultimately march to Treasury, march to the presidency, and have that bridge between fighting at a university level and fighting at a state level. The university was demanding that if they were to come to the university assembly and commit to this, that we would end the shutdown. Both the university and students knew very well that immediately when we opened our gates, when classes started properly, we would lose all bargaining power with the state.
It is with deep regret that we announced the postponement of the General Assembly that was to be held today. The protesting students effectively wanted the General Assembly, and they wanted the march to the Constitutional Court to continue. But they refused to commit that the academic program will commence on Monday, as previously we had discussed.
We're just trying to safely evacuate them from the building. Invite them to come here and focus with us and dance and sing and do all these nice things. But comrades, we must make sure that that building is evacuated. Amanda, always high morale and high discipline, comrades.
Did we think it was going to be rough? Yes. But what would you ever rather have me do? Lose the academic year? So that's the question that I was confronted with.
They were saying to us, we don't want to talk to you. So we'll send you, bullets. In other ways, one could say that, you know, the university was basically outsourcing its responsibility.
Continue. After running battles with authorities on Wits campus, the students then were pushed off onto the streets of Bramfontein.
Down the road, shooting deliberately into the church grounds. I mean, that was extraordinarily provocative. The most moving statement that I've been getting from my students and my friends have been thanks for bearing witness.
Absolutely no reason for the kinds of scenes that we were seeing at a place like Wits University. In fact, we must characterize that for what it is. When you are looking at the throwing of stones and so on, that's vandalism, it's thuggery, it's something that should have no place in a democratic South Africa, no matter what the issues are.
President Jacob Zuma has set up a ministerial task team to normalize the situation at higher education institutions.
In 2016, we really could see the connection between university managements and government working together on this agenda to dehumanize students.
This is an anti-ANC government agenda by elements who could not be able to win power through the ballot box, and they want to discredit the ANC. It's an ultra-left, old ultra-left elements, Trotskyites, who have never really had political power in South Africa.
These people are very good. They know how to operate. They would not deposit money into your account. They know how to bring cash to you. But it's a responsibility of the Department of State Security to deal with that.
We had the ANC Youth League National President, Colin Maine, make statements to the extent that he said, we who are still protesting are third forces, we are terrorists, we don't know what we're doing, and we want to destroy this country. And that is coming from a radical or group that's supposed to be radical.
The EFF has been supporting Fees Must Fall throughout. In Parliament, they've taken it every corner. The EFF has awakened the black masses of our people. There's, in essence, revitalized our people. We've been in slumber for too long.
We shouldn't be surprised if political parties have an interest. Of course they do. Okay? This was one of the most important protests in the post-94 period. But to then suggest that the student protests have been orchestrated and controlled by an outside force, it's either deliberately mischievous or betrays a profound lack of understanding of the student politics.
So they want to taint the protest, criminalize us, and only after that will they do anything with us, and it'll be justifiable because we're criminals, by the way.
At every university, no matter what time of day the strike was,
you were able to have an interdict within an hour and a half with scopes that were so broad that they would essentially ban protest.
Student leader Mcebo Dlamini is to appear in the Hillbrow Magistrates Court this morning in what police say was part of an investigation into the intimidation and violence that we've seen.
Mcebo Dlamini has been denied bail by the Johannesburg Magistrates Court. Dlamini is facing charges of malicious damage to property, theft, assault and possession of dangerous weapons.
Political arrests are now being used to kill the movement.
Then there was a situation where the Minister of State Security, David Mahlogo, directly now trying to contact students, you know. At 4 o'clock in the morning, you'd have, you know, people coming to you and saying, you know, the minister wants to meet with you in Pretoria at his house. And it is then that we realized that actually what we're dealing with is bigger than, you know, our imagination. And now we knew that we were really touching the nerve. And the only way we could defend ourselves was to stay in the public eye.
Let us go back to campus peacefully. No car is going to be harmed. No shop is going to be looted. Not in our name. Let us march, comrades, peacefully.
There's safety in numbers. As long as we're in public and we're in numbers, we're safe. But there's definitely a targeted attempt to get us. I mean, Mcebo is sitting in prison. My colleagues are sitting in hospital. Wiani now has to go into some form of hiding.
Despite the moves towards having this shutdown continue, a lot of classes were going ahead. And it made no sense that exams and normal academic activities continue when people are in jail, when people are in hospital, when the entire campus is far from normal. There's police all over. There's police in your exam room. There's police outside.
We are on the list, there's no doubt about that. But I always say that I can't hide like a rat. We have to come out and do what we have to do, be strategic, not be alone, be with students, that's our safest space. But also, you know, if they're going to come for you, they're going to come for you.
We were walking to an open area of grass, and along that walkway, that particular group of police had just kind of popped out of nowhere. I tried to speak to the police officer and, you know, me trying to have an interaction with him. As I walked forward, they formed into line, and already I was scared, but I had to try and be very, you know, brave for the students who were following us.
Information that student leader Shaeera Kalla, who is believed to have been shot 10 times, is still receiving treatment her wounds are being dressed at this stage at the wellness center here on the university's campus.
I tried to speak to the police officer. I tried to speak to him. I tried to explain to him that we didn't want any trouble and that if they wanted us to disperse, we'd disperse peacefully. But we didn't even get to that point because it didn't seem that they were there to make a decision. It seemed that all the decisions had already been made. And I said, please, please, just listen to me. And they were swearing at me. They were being very aggressive. I was very small in comparison. These were big police officers, and I... At the end, it seemed to have been that it was 13 rubber bullets. It just felt like a spray of hard things hitting my back, and I couldn't sit or lie on my back for about a month.
all of that is insignificant to the kind of disgust and disappointment you have with a government who would shoot its own children.
If I was shot, maybe it would have made sense because I perform aggression in almost all the time. But Shaeera, you know, is always panting on, you know, reason and always asking that we approach it differently, always asking that we do different things differently. Now, when they did that to Shaeera, we knew that this is actually a game to break us.
As a general rule, our academic program was completed. And that was our responsibility. It was my responsibility and every academic's responsibility to ensure the 2016 academic year was not lost.
The spirit of Fees Must Fall just found room in our bodies and used us. And we pray that it will find room in other bodies.
We love Fees Must Fall. I will continue fighting for free education until we get it, but not the same way. The same strategies that we were using, they're not sustainable anymore. So we will do what we did in the beginning. We'll surprise people the next time.
I can stand here and talk about the future of the movement, but it would be disingenuous given that this movement doesn't belong to me. I don't decide. It is a collective process that we hold in very sacred regard. And students will ultimately take this where it needs to be. And I have faith that we will achieve our demand for free, decolonized education, but not without a fight.
Kwa 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 kirla yeza, mama woza sambe.